Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Raise a Healthy Child in Spite of Your Doctor. One of America's leading pediatricians puts parents back in control of their children's health. By Robert S. Mendelsohn, M.D. Narrated by Chris Sorensen. Introduction. This book reflects my belief that in pediatrics, as in other specialties, a great deal of bad medicine is practiced in the United States. That does not imply, however, that doctors have less integrity or compassion than the rest of mankind. The shortcomings lie within the philosophy and teaching of medicine, not in the character of those who are taught. Doctors aren't culprits. Like their patients, they are victims of the system. They are the first to be impaired by medical education's preoccupation with intervention rather than prevention, its infatuation with drugs and technology, and the indefensible rituals, mores, and egotistical attitudes that are burned into the brain of every student who survives the rigid and often irrelevant curriculum and training. They emerge with their heads so stuffed with institutionalized foolishness that there is no room left for common sense. I don't exempt myself from this criticism of other pediatricians. I confess that I began my medical practice believing most of what I had been taught, and my patients paid the price for many years. Fortunately, perhaps because I began teaching medical students myself, I learned to question many of the medical principles that had been drilled into me and to suspect every new drug, surgical procedure, and medical innovation that came along. I soon discovered that most of them couldn't withstand rigorous scientific evaluation, and that an incredible percentage of the wonder drugs and revolutionary procedures soon disappeared when it was discovered that they did more harm than good. In my two previous books, Confessions of a Medical Heretic and Male Practice, How Doctors Manipulate Women, I sought to caution my readers about the hazards of blind faith in the American medical profession. It was not my purpose then, nor is it now, to discourage my readers from seeking needed medical attention. Despite the shortcomings of their education and training, doctors do save lives and they do make sick people well. They are at their best when challenged by medical emergencies and at their worst when they feel compelled, as they were taught to do, to treat people who aren't really sick. I hoped, in those books and this one, to alert you to the deficiencies of medical practice so that you would be prepared to defend yourself against dangerous and inappropriate medical treatment. As a subsidiary objective, I reasoned that if enough patients began to question their doctors about the treatments they prescribed, the doctors might begin to question them too. It may be coincidental, and much of the progress must be credited to other critics within and outside my profession, but there is strong evidence that these objectives are being achieved. Many doctors are being prompted by their patients and by the media to question their own medical beliefs. I know this is true, because my colleagues frequently tell me so, and because surveys of doctors indicate that a growing number of patients are refusing to take their doctor's opinions at face value. Patients have become less in awe of their doctors, less docile and compliant. Doctors are no longer, in the minds of many patients, invested with scientific infallibility. Instead, they are being compelled to search for plausible answers to tough questions about the drugs they prescribe, the tests they order, and the surgery they recommend. The impact is great when a doctor repeatedly finds himself looking for defensive answers that aren't there. Many of the doctors I know welcome these changes, but others find them disconcerting when they are unable to explain or to defend many of the drugs and procedures that they have prescribed routinely in the past. In either case, however, the new awareness of the shortcomings of conventional medical practice is yielding constructive changes. When doctors are compelled to question their own behavior, to reconsider objectively many of the things that they have been taught, and to cast an eye on prevention rather than intervention, their patients inevitably enjoy beneficial results. Many reforms have emerged in the past 3 or 4 years that constitute belated recognition by doctors that the side effects of many drugs are more dangerous than the ailments they seek to correct, that elective surgery is often unnecessary and always dangerous, and that the risks of many routine tests, x-rays, and examinations are greater than those of the diseases that they are employed to detect. During the last few years, many of medicine's most cherished procedures have come into disrepute because they could not withstand the public scrutiny to which they were being subjected. For example, the American Academy of Pediatrics has advised against routine administration of chest x-rays when children are admitted to hospitals, a tacit acknowledgement of the potential cumulative hazards of radiology. The Academy has also reversed its position on routine use of the tuberculin test, except in areas of high incidence of the disease. Hopefully, this may be the first step toward elimination of all dangerous and unnecessary screening tests and immunizations that benefit the doctors who administer them more than their patients. The routine annual physical examination has been scrapped by the American Medical Association. The American Cancer Society, ACS, no longer recommends routine annual pap smears, and for a time also stopped recommending routine periodic mammographies. Although no convincing new evidence has emerged to support the decision, other than the outcry of underemployed radiologists, the ACS has reversed its position again. It now maintains that a mammography every 1 or 2 years is a safe and highly recommended practice for symptomless women, ages 40 to 50. This is in contradiction of the guidelines set by the National Cancer Institute in 1977, which restrict X-ray screening in this age group to women with a personal or family history of breast cancer. In my view, annual mammographies for symptom-free women are a form of self-fulfilling diagnosis. Perform enough of them and they may produce the breast cancer they are used to detect. Routine chest x-rays, once considered so essential that mobile units provided access to them, have gone by the boards. Although the pharmaceutical companies keep churning out new drugs, there is increasing patient resistance to over-medication, and fewer drugs are being prescribed. The number of prescriptions filled in 1980 was 100 million fewer than in 1974. Perhaps as a consequence, the drug industry is putting enormous pressure on the Food and Drug Administration to permit it to advertise prescription drugs to consumers, not just to doctors. Tranquilizer prescriptions dropped from 104.5 million in 1973 to 70.8 million in 1981. The use of Valium, a major source of drug overdose fatalities, has been cut in half from a peak of 62 million prescriptions in 1975. Sleeping pill prescriptions dropped from a high of 40 million to 21 million in 1980. Increasing numbers of women are rejecting the pill and intrauterine birth control devices because of the hazards they present. Breastfeeding is on the rise, a boon to both mothers and babies, despite the continuing failure of many obstetricians and pediatricians to encourage it with vigor. Obstetrical procedures are being questioned and modified, and there is a slow but gradual movement toward natural childbirth and even home birth. These remarkable alterations of cherished medical practices and procedures makes it clear that the profession is responding to a rising chorus of criticism. Not so, however, in my own specialty, pediatrics, which has emerged relatively unscathed and unaltered until now. In the pages that follow, I will expose pediatric practice to the same critical scrutiny that I devoted to other segments of the medical profession in earlier books. But because pediatrics is my specialty, which I have practiced and taught for more than a quarter century, I feel competent to do more than point out its flaws. This book will offer appropriate advice to parents who want to avoid the risk and expense of needless intervention while providing the care that will assure the health of their children. For literary convenience, yours and mine, the pronoun he will be used throughout this book to refer to both boys and girls. Without attempting to be encyclopedic, I will offer specific advice on the medical problems that your child is likely to encounter from the moment of conception to the day he leaves the nest. You will learn how to tell when he is seriously ill, how you can deal with problems that don't require medical attention, how to determine when you should call your doctor, and how to assure that the treatments prescribed for your children are appropriate and safe. With this basic information, all parents can assume a larger role in maintaining the health of their children. However, this does not mean that you should assume the doctor's role, doing badly those things that a good doctor can do well. Despite the deficiencies of medical schools, doctors do learn technical skills that parents should not try to perform. This book will teach you what you need to know to care for most of the ills that may afflict your child, but also how to know when prudence demands that you employ a doctor's skills. If you read the chapters that follow carefully, they will resolve most of your doubts and fears about the health of your child and help you prepare him or her for a long, healthy, and happy life. Robert S. Mendelsohn, M.D., Evanston, Illinois. Chapter 1. Most things get better by morning. This book was written for parents who are seeking advice on how to raise healthy children. Parents who are eager to give their kids a good start in life without entrusting all of the medical decisions to their pediatricians. My purpose is to help you determine when your child needs medical attention and when medical intervention should be avoided because it may do more harm than good. I also intend to alert you to the hazards of drugs, tests, x-rays, and other treatments that your pediatrician may want to employ. Forms of medical intervention that may actually inflict damage on your child. Pediatricians enjoy one significant advantage over other medical specialists because they can exploit the wholesome tendency of most parents to be more concerned about the health of their children than about their own health. Think about that for a moment. If you awaken at night with a splitting headache, what do you do? If you are like most adults, you probably get up, take an aspirin, and go back to bed. Very likely, you'll soon fall asleep and feel fine when you wake up in the morning. Now, consider how you react when your child awakes in the middle of the night with the same symptom. Your first impulse may well be to talk to your pediatrician as soon as you can get him on the phone. If you reach the doctor instead of his answering service, his response is predictable. Chances are he'll ask, "Did you take his temperature?" Then, whatever your response, "Well, I don't think it is anything to worry about. Give him an aspirin and bring him to the office in the morning." You hang up the phone, regretting that you made the call, give Jimmy the aspirin, and he soon goes back to sleep. So do you. You are relieved when Jimmy awakens in the morning, eagerly demanding his breakfast and chipper as can be. After he's been fed, you wonder whether to take him to the doctor or ignore that request and spare yourself the effort and expense. That's the way that scene is usually played, and it's a bad scene that parents should avoid. With a simple headache as the only symptom, there was no need to call the doctor, and even less reason to see him in the morning. Unless your child displays evidence of serious illness, a visit to his pediatrician will yield no benefit, but may invite needless medical interventions that could make a well child sick. If you have read other books on child health, you will appreciate that this is an unconventional view. Most of those books are written by doctors, and even those that honestly acknowledge the self-limiting nature of most childhood ailments are consistent with all the others in one respect. Whatever the symptom or ailment, see your doctor is the bottom line. The thesis of this book, predicated on nearly 3 decades of pediatric teaching and practice, is not see your doctor. That may surprise you, but what I have learned during those years is that the vast majority of childhood illnesses do not require medical attention, and that when they receive it needlessly, the treatment given may do more harm than good. Consequently, my advice to parents, based on long observation of the behavior of other doctors and my own experience in treating thousands of patients, is avoid your doctor whenever you can. Let me share with you some other premises that form the basis for that advice and the recommendations that I will make in the pages that follow. At least 95% of the ailments that children are prey to will heal themselves and do not require medical attention. Too often, the risk of careless or needless medical intervention is greater than the dangers of the illness itself. Pediatricians spend most of their time treating parental distress. The child rarely needs treatment but gets it anyway and is subjected to the consequences, and it is the parent who gets the relief. That's because most doctors believe that parents demand, or at least expect, that they will do something for the child. What concerned parents really need is reassurance, and what their kids don't need is treatment when they aren't really sick. Most doctors won't take the time to provide meaningful parental reassurance. It is quicker and easier to write a prescription for the child. Mother Nature, mothers, grandmothers, yes, even fathers and grandfathers, are the best doctors around because they do not share the typical doctor's compulsion to interfere with the body's efforts and ability to heal itself. At least 90% of the drugs prescribed by pediatricians are unnecessary and a costly risk to the child who takes them. All drugs are toxic and thus dangerous, per se. Beyond that, excessive childhood use of prescription drugs may generate the belief that there is a pill for every ill. This may lead the child to seek chemical solutions to emotional problems later in life. At least 90% of children's surgery is unnecessary, needlessly exposing the patient to the risks of death from the surgery itself, from anesthesia, or from infections contracted in the hospital, which is an inescapably germ-ridden environment. Most pediatricians have received little or no education covering the fundamentals of nutrition and pharmacology, and no emphasis is placed on these vital subjects in medical school. Their patients suffer because of the pediatrician's ignorance of the impact of diet on health and of the hazards and side effects of the drugs he prescribes. Parents need to learn when to call a doctor and what they can do without a doctor's intervention to reinforce the body's ability to heal itself. I realize that I would be placing an unfair burden on you as a parent if I simply described the shortcomings of pediatric practice and urged you to avoid doctors and assume greater responsibility for your children's health. It is one thing for you to accept that kind of advice when your own health is involved, and quite another to accept it when you are making medical decisions in behalf of your beloved child. This understandable ambivalence places parents at the mercy of their pediatricians. Most of the children seen by pediatricians require no treatment, but they often get it anyway. Your child's doctor has strong incentives to make you feel better by treating your child. That behavior does not square with my ethical precepts, but in practice, the pediatrician who employs it is rewarded financially and psychologically for curing a child who wasn't seriously ill. The financial incentives derive from the fact that a dwindling number of patients and an increasing oversupply of pediatricians are combining to curtail the income that pediatric practices generate. In order to stabilize his annual income, the doctor has an incentive to intervene more aggressively, performing questionable tests and treatments so that he can extract increased fees from each patient he treats. This incentive will undoubtedly grow in the years ahead, as the oversupply of pediatricians becomes an even larger problem for the doctors in this field. The psychological incentive stems from the pediatrician's need to feel that he is doing something productive. That's not easy for him to do when most of the patients he sees don't really need his skills. Surveys of pediatricians have shown that many do not find their work rewarding. As many as one-third indicate that they are seriously considering changing their career direction to obtain greater challenge or because they feel burned out. For some, the temptation to display their knowledge and thus win the gratitude of parents, even when the treatment is superfluous and even potentially damaging, can be overwhelming. This indefensible medical behavior is a real threat to your child. You need to be constantly alert to the deficiencies of pediatric practice so that you can monitor the behavior of your child's doctor and avoid hazardous treatments that he doesn't need. But simply knowing what's wrong with pediatricians isn't much help when your child has a headache or a pain in the belly or a racking cough and a fever to boot. You need the ability to identify the conditions that require medical attention and distinguish them from those that will most likely cure themselves. Most parents also need to know more about the treatments to avoid or even reject because they are inappropriate and potentially harmful to their children. Because most childhood illnesses respond to normal bodily defenses that may be impeded by medical treatment, use of your natural skills is usually preferable to those of a doctor in giving your child the help he needs. Moreover, you will play the principal role in helping your child avoid illnesses by providing the wholesome nutrition that he needs and by making certain that he avoids the foods he shouldn't have. This book is intended to help you by providing the information you need to sharpen your skills and give you confidence as you raise your healthy child. Chapter 2. Parents and grandparents are wiser than doctors. Parents often believe I'm joking when I tell them that mothers, fathers, and grandparents are more capable than doctors of managing the health of children. Yet I firmly believe it, for reasons that are at once simple and profound. Unless you have passed the half-century mark and were brought up outside the major cities of our country, you can't be expected to remember the classic family doctor, for today there are scarcely any to be found. Those of us who can remember them are apt to do so with feelings of warmth and affection. For we recall the family doctor as a friendly, sensitive, unpretentious, reassuring, compassionate figure in our lives. The family doctor of that era often had been intimately involved with our families for 2, 3, and even 4 generations. He knew each of us as individual personalities, was sensitive to our attitudes, moods, and idiosyncrasies. He viewed us as human beings in need of help, not as clinical subjects for all of the technological and pharmacological interventions that doctors today have substituted for careful examination and common sense. Our family doctor knew our medical histories and often those of our parents and grandparents as well. Most of the time, he listened to us without impatience, answered our questions thoughtfully, calmed our fears, and explained simply and clearly what was going on in our bodies and our minds. His office was warm, comfortable, and non-threatening, and he had a personality to match it. If we felt too sick to go there, he came to us, believing that it made more sense for a healthy doctor to visit a sick patient than vice versa. He didn't let his medical education and his ego get in the way of his humanity and his common sense. If we needed a pill, we got one. But more often, he allayed our fears and anxieties with nothing more than calm reassurance and a friendly pat on the head, and let nature do its work without interference. I'll confess that in my mind's eye, this appealing ghost may be somewhat romanticized, but even allowing for that, what he was is what today's doctors should be. Unfortunately, few of them are. So it falls to you, the parent, to assume that role in maintaining the health of your child. How can I assert that parents with no medical training are better able than pediatricians to meet most of the health needs of their children? Simply because you are willing and able to give your children time and attention, and your doctor is not. The most important elements in the diagnosis of illness are behavior change, appearance, and the medical history of the child. As the parent, you are extremely sensitive to your child's behavior patterns, quick to note a change in his or her appearance, and totally familiar with your child's medical history, your own, and probably those of your parents as well. The typical pediatrician whose assembly line spews out 30, 40, or even 50 patients a day doesn't know your child as you do, and has neither the time nor the inclination to learn. All of his technology, his tests and shots and x-rays and drugs and theory, in most instances, are no substitute for the common sense care that you, as an informed parent, can provide. That's why your pediatrician can never be the primary authority on whether your child is sick and why you should never let him be. You are far better qualified to judge the physical condition of your child than your doctor is, simply because you know the child better. You live with your kids and observe their behavior and appearance with interest and concern day by day. Guidelines for diagnosis. If your child doesn't feel sick, look sick, and act sick, the odds are that he isn't sick, or certainly not sick enough to require medical attention. How many times have you been tempted to call the doctor when your child complained of a stomach ache or headache, and then were glad that you didn't when you found him roughhousing with his brothers and sisters within an hour or two? I have just given you the first of three rules that you can use to guide you in diagnosis, but I'll repeat it because it is the most important. Rule number one. If your child doesn't feel sick, look sick, and act sick, he probably isn't sick. Rule number two. Give Mother Nature ample time to work her magic before you expose your child to the potential physical and emotional side effects of treatments that your doctor may administer. The human body has a remarkable capacity to heal itself, a capacity that in most cases surpasses anything that medical science can do, and it doesn't produce unwanted side effects. Rule number three. Common sense is the most useful tool in dealing with illness. Your doctor is less likely to employ it than you are, and certainly no more able, because that's not what they taught him in medical school. Granted, there are infrequent illnesses of critical nature for which competent medical treatment is essential, but in the case of children, they are the exception rather than the rule. The obvious question is, how can parents tell which ones are serious and which are not? The answer is that you can't always tell, and for that matter, neither can your doctor. However, when you have finished reading this book, you will be able to determine the seriousness of most of your child's ailments and will need to consult a doctor only in the limited number of instances when you are in doubt. I have observed in both the teaching and the practice of medicine that most doctors do a competent job of treating patients who are very sick and a miserable job of caring for those who are well. This is the major flaw in medical education. The medical student and the pediatric resident, for that matter, learn precious little about how to keep children well because their education begins with the premise that everyone who comes to their office will require treatment. In medical school, the student gets about 3 months of pediatric instruction, devoted largely to the discussion of childhood diseases that had importance decades ago when the curriculum was written, but now have virtually disappeared. He absorbs a lot of biased information about immunizations, but is taught very little about pharmacology, despite the fact that as a practicing physician, he'll hook more kids on drugs than the most diligent pusher in town. Only about 60 hours are devoted specifically to pharmacology during 4 years in the typical medical school, and most of that time is spent absorbing irrelevant information about abstract pharmacological theory. Ultimately, most of what doctors know about the drugs they administer to their patients is taught them by an army of pharmaceutical salesmen and promoters euphemistically known as detail men. If you were to equate this relationship to the distribution of street drugs, the detail man would be the supplier and the doctor the pusher. Doctors aren't taught the importance of nutrition. Virtually nothing is done in medical school to teach students that nutrition may often be the most important element of diagnosis and treatment. Consequently, they begin their practice unaware that food allergies are the primary cause of many childhood ailments, and that adequate nutrition is the basis of good health. This ignorance compels them to use drugs in the treatment of diseases that could have been cured with a simple change in diet. If the medical student has the opportunity to get some brief hands-on experience in a well baby clinic, he won't learn very much about the real world of medicine he is soon to enter. Virtually all of his time will be spent administering immunizations, dispensing vitamins, and passing out samples of infant formula supplied by the manufacturer's detail man. The patients he sees have come to the clinic for routine, periodic physical examinations, so he'll rarely see a patient who is really sick and isn't taught how to recognize one who is. Fledgling doctors are taught to scoff at the holistic health practitioners, at nutritional therapy, and at any other form of health care that does not require an MD. They learn to rail at quackery, yet no one points out to them the abundance of quackery that exists within conventional medicine itself. How can any doctor rationalize condemning those who treat patients with Laetril when he has been guilty of feeding his own patients Bendectin, Oriflex, Zomax, or thalidomide until they were removed from the market because of the damage attributed to them? What little doctors learn about breastfeeding, the most effective long-term health protection a child can obtain, is usually taught by male doctors who, for obvious reasons, have little interest or experience in this vital function. Despite its enormous influence on the development and ultimate health of your baby, which I will discuss later, I heard only one lecture on breastfeeding during 4 years in medical school. But the formula makers were wide awake while my instructors slept, and I was brainwashed by a deluge of literature that they supplied. What students do learn in medical school seems to relate as much to succeeding in business as to keeping their patients well. They are taught to behave like doctors, to project the appearance and demeanor of omnipotence, so their patients will hold them in awe. You may assume that the inadequacies of medical school are overcome during the pediatric residency, but they're not. There, the resident deals with hospitalized patients and learns to use cannon to fend off mosquitoes because of the emphasis on hazardous diagnostic technology, surgery, and other drastic procedures that are typical of the hospital routine. He still gets little or no experience in dealing with the vast majority of childhood illnesses that are brought to a pediatrician for care. That translates in private practice to a compulsion to overreact to simple illnesses with dramatic forms of intervention. It is a hazard that demands your constant vigilance. I'll be more specific about that throughout this book. When he completes his residency and opens his first office, the typical pediatrician is poorly educated and largely unskilled. He knows very little about the risks of the drastic treatments he administers, the side effects of the drugs he prescribes, the risks of the surgery he orders or performs, the possible inaccuracy of the tests on which he relies, or the shortcomings of the medical technology he employs. He knows virtually nothing about the most critical items in pediatric health care: the impact of nutritional, allergic, psychological, and emotional factors on the well-being of his patients. Pediatricians actually spend most of their time treating patients who don't need treatment and refer to specialists most of those who are injured or seriously ill. In fact, the referral of patients to other specialists is such an integral part of their function that they are sometimes referred to as access managers within the medical profession. Perhaps because I've been a pediatrician for so long, I have little remaining conviction that a specialist is needed to perform this function. Most childhood illnesses can be treated competently within the home, by informed and caring parents. When medical treatment is indicated, it can be provided as well by general practitioners or family practitioners, or by specialists to whom their patients are referred. In fact, given the opportunity, nurse practitioners could perform most of these functions equally well. That is actually the practice in many other countries that have only a relative handful of pediatricians, yet produce medical outcomes that are better than ours. It may seem anomalous, but those outcomes are better because there are fewer pediatricians. Children in those countries are healthier because there is less medical intervention and thus less exposure to potentially damaging drugs and medical technology. Although American medical schools teach their students very little about pharmacology, they do teach them to exploit all of the new drugs and medical technologies that are available. New drugs and equipment appear almost daily, spawned by the laboratories of the pharmaceutical industry and the medical equipment manufacturers. More often than not, they are unproven and potentially unsafe. Most parents assume, as they should have the right to, that they can rely on the Federal Food and Drug Administration to keep drugs off the market until they have been proven safe for human use. Most doctors, who don't have the right to because they know better, operate on that premise too. This confidence in the FDA is misplaced, because virtually all drugs are released without appropriate or significant human trials. They may have immediate or short-term effects on some patients that have not been discovered. Even more likely is the possibility of cumulative and long-term effects, which I will discuss more fully in a later chapter. These long-term effects are never known at the time new drugs are introduced, and perhaps not for decades after that, when untold harm has already been done to unsuspecting victims. The history of medicine here and abroad is replete with examples of drugs approved for human use that were removed from the market only after countless victims bore evidence of the damage they caused. You may recall some of the more sensational examples: DES, MER-29, thalidomide. To compound the problem, although the FDA has the power to keep unproven drugs off the market, it has virtually no authority to force their removal once they have been approved. It also lacks an effective post-marketing surveillance mechanism that would alert it and the public to the appearance of destructive effects from the drugs that have been released. That's why the hazards of drugs are most often publicly revealed in European nations, which do exercise post-marketing surveillance that brings their risks to light. Doctors rarely investigate the drugs they use. It is a rare doctor indeed who investigates the tests to which a drug or a treatment has been subjected before he begins to use it on his patients. Even when doubts are raised about commonly prescribed drugs, most doctors pay no attention to them. The manufacturers of several of the drugs doctors most frequently prescribe for children have been ordered by the FDA to offer proof that they are safe and effective, or remove them from the market. The manufacturers have been sparring with the FDA for years while still selling these drugs. In most instances, they have yet to come up with proof that these drugs are any good, yet doctors keep right on prescribing them. I'm not talking about a handful of drugs, but literally hundreds of them. It seems almost incredible, but American parents spend millions of dollars every year on drugs that their doctors have prescribed without any evidence that the drugs are effective or safe, or worse, in the face of responsible allegations that they are not. Of the 30 drugs labeled ineffective by the FDA that were most frequently prescribed in 1979, more than half, including the top three, are often prescribed for children. Those on the list include Dimetapp, Actifed, Donatol, Ornaid Spansules, Phenergan Expectorant, Tussornaid, Phenergan VC Expectorant with Codeine, Actifed C Expectorant, Bentil, Phenergan Expectorant Plain, Benylin Cough Syrup, Marix and Marix DF, Dimetane Expectorant, Ambenol expectorant, Dimetane expectorant DC, and Teldrin. Next time your doctor prescribes one of them for your child, ask him why he is using a drug that the manufacturer has been unable to defend as doing any good. During the early years of my practice, when I was still naive enough to believe what they had taught me in medical school, I was guilty of the same sort of behavior. During my pediatric residency, I was taught to use X-rays to treat the tonsils, acne, ringworm of the scalp, and enlarged lymph and thymus glands. No one told me that I need to have any concern about the long-term consequences of this treatment, nor did it occur to me to question whether I might be causing my patients future harm. In those days, I took everything on faith and expected my patients to do likewise. I'm ashamed of that now and suspicious of every new medical fad, because those X-ray treatments were responsible for a virtual epidemic of thyroid cancer among patients subjected to them. The damage that was done is still being discovered every day. Even more tragic is the fact that in the case of enlarged lymph and thymus glands, we were treating non-ailments. Their size ultimately diminished without treatment in the natural order of things. Who knows what the future consequences will be of the things pediatric residents are being taught today? They are learning to use bilirubin lights to treat infant jaundice, tympanostomy for ear infections, antibiotics for almost everything, hormones to control growth, powerful drugs to modify child behavior, and other drugs, tests, immunizations, and procedures whose long-term effects are unknown. The consequences have yet to be fully revealed, but if you re-examine the previous disasters that litter the path of medical progress, you can be sure they will be many and tragic. If there is a given about medical practice, it is that doctors don't seem to learn anything from their mistakes, and that most of them seem oblivious to the basic tenet of the Hippocratic Oath, first do no harm. Doctors do a lot of harm, but the very structure of their medical education over time makes them insensitive to the harm that they do. We want our doctors to be caring and sensitive, Daniel Borenstein of the UCLA School of Medicine said recently. But if they are overly caring, it's difficult for them to continue to function. Throughout medical school, there's a hardening of the spirit. The pediatric resident may become quite skilled in certain mechanical procedures frequently performed in hospitals, such as inserting needles into veins and arteries, performing spinal taps, and even inserting tracheal and bronchial tubes. However, these skills diminish rapidly after he leaves the hospital and stops using them. Within a year or two, you can't depend on him to retain many of the skills he learned. Fortunately for him and for his patients, it doesn't make much difference because he rarely needs to use them. They were typically learned while treating children in pediatric clinics who were the victims of economic deprivation, inadequate hygiene, and poor nutrition, and consequently suffered ailments rarely seen in middle-class or affluent pediatric practices. Since most pediatricians go where the money is, there isn't much chance that they'll continue to treat poor children when they enter private practice. In fact, most of the time they'll be treating kids who don't need treatment because they aren't seriously ill. What doctors are taught to do about mistakes? As part of my preparation for entering private practice, I was taught during my pediatric residency what to do if I made a terrible mistake. I wasn't told what to tell the parents of the child so that they could handle their grief more adequately, nor was I given any ethical standards to adhere to. Instead, I was admonished to call my malpractice insurance carrier immediately and let him tell me how to proceed. If I had to say anything publicly about a grievous, perhaps fatal error, the magic phrase was, "What happened to this poor child was one in a million." That's why when something goes wrong, you'll often hear a doctor say, "It was one in a million." In Toronto, there was the famous case of Stephen Yuz, who entered the hospital for sick children and was diagnosed as having psychological vomiting. He died some days later from an intestinal obstruction. It was one in a million, of course, as was the death of a Chicago child as the result of an asthma test. I have attempted in this chapter to dissuade you from having blind faith in your pediatrician, and to point out that when you seek medical attention that your child doesn't really need, you may expose him to greater risks. Medical attention should be your last resort, not your first, when your child is sick. The vast majority of childhood illnesses will respond to natural bodily defenses, fortified by your own skills, loving attention, and common sense. Chapter 3. How Doctors Can Make Healthy Kids Sick. If you think about the relationships you have had with doctors, I suspect you'll be surprised to discover that they're unlike those you have with anyone else who provides you with a service. The typical doctor-patient relationship is revealed in a phrase that has become part of the language: doctor's orders. Doctors do give orders to their patients. Lawyers, accountants, and other professionals give advice. When you take your child to a pediatrician, he conducts a physical examination that is too often cursory rather than thorough, orders tests and x-rays, makes a diagnosis, decides on a course of treatment, often requiring drugs, and sometimes admits him to a hospital for an extended stay. He does all of this with a minimum of explanation, without asking for your approval, usually without warning you about the risks and potential side effects of the treatment he is giving, and without telling you what it is all going to cost. When it is all over, he will expect you to pay your bill, even if the diagnosis was wrong or the treatment didn't work and your child is still sick. Doctors, in short, have minimal accountability to their patients for anything they do. Americans clearly are at the mercy of their doctors, and as a parent, you are even more so because your concern for a child who can't make his own decisions makes you particularly vulnerable. Your child, in turn, becomes vulnerable to treatment that is often painful and debilitating. Because doctors are taught in medical school to submerge any emotional response to human suffering, they simply don't pay enough attention to the pain they inflict and the damage that their treatments may cause. Among doctors as a group, I believe the pediatrician is the most dangerous because he appears to be the most benign. The image of a pediatrician is most often that of a smiling, kindly, caring professional who, along with his prescriptions, gives balloons and lollipops to your kids. He undeservedly escapes the opprobrium that is sometimes directed toward obstetricians and surgeons, who are more likely to be viewed as callous and money-grubbing. Why pediatricians are dangerous. The confidence inspired by the demeanor of pediatricians is, in my experience, undeserved. It tends to mask the elements of pediatric practice that are threatening to your child. Let me recite briefly some of the reasons why I believe pediatricians are dangerous, and then get into the most serious of them later in greater detail. 1. The pediatrician serves as the recruiter for the medical profession. He indoctrinates your child from birth into a lifelong dependence on medical intervention. It begins with a succession of needless well-baby checkups and immunizations, and then moves on to routine annual physical examinations and endless treatment of minor ailments that would cure themselves if they were left alone. 2. Pediatricians are the least likely of all specialists to tell parents about the potential side effects of the drugs and treatments they prescribe. What pediatrician ever told mothers of the evidence linking infant formula to high blood lead levels and sudden infant death syndrome, SIDS? What pediatrician, until pressured to do so by media revelations, ever told parents of the risk of epilepsy and mental retardation associated with the immunizations that he performs? What pediatrician tells parents that antibiotics should be reserved for cases in which there is no acceptable option, that frequent and indiscriminate use may have adverse future consequences for the child. 3. The pediatrician's wanton prescribing of powerful drugs indoctrinates children from birth with the philosophy of a pill for every ill. This may lead the child to the belief that there is a drug to treat every condition and that drugs are an appropriate response to normal feelings of frustration, depression, anxiety, inadequacy, insecurity, etc. Doctors are directly responsible for hooking millions of people on prescription drugs. They are also indirectly responsible for the plight of millions more who turn to illegal drugs because they were taught at an early age that drugs can cure anything, including psychological and emotional conditions that ails them. 4. Pediatrics is among the lowest paid of the medical specialties. Consequently, because he has greater need for the income they generate, the pediatrician is more likely than other doctors to order unnecessary x-rays and tests. The risks to the patient are twofold. First, potentially harmful effects from the tests and the x-rays themselves. Second, the danger that inappropriate treatment may be given because the pediatrician discounted clinical evidence in making his diagnosis and relied on test results that too often are unreliable. 5. Pediatricians are so accustomed to seeing patients who aren't really sick that they often fail to recognize the ones who are. I have been an expert witness in many malpractice suits that bear this out. Board-certified pediatricians have overlooked important life-threatening conditions because they had forgotten what to look for in a sick child and missed the symptoms that should have alerted them to a serious condition. Meningitis is an outstanding example of this shortcoming because it is today one of the rarities in pediatrics. It used to be 95% fatal and now is 95% curable. But only if the pediatrician recognizes the symptoms and identifies the disease in time. Every pediatrician during his residency is taught how to diagnose meningitis. In fact, it is one of the few really useful things that he is taught. But that lesson is often blotted out after years of examining a procession of healthy children. To make matters worse, the pediatrician gets so accustomed to treating non-ailments that when he does properly diagnose a sick child, he may no longer remember the appropriate treatment. 6. Because they see more children in order to enjoy a profitable practice, pediatricians don't spend enough time with their patients to diagnose and treat them properly. Every competent physician knows that 85% of an accurate diagnosis is based on the patient's history, 10% on a thorough physical examination, and the remainder on laboratory tests and x-rays. It takes at least half an hour to an hour to take an adequate history and to conduct a thorough physical exam. Pediatricians typically spend 10 minutes with a patient and thus fail to discern much of what they need to know for a reliable diagnosis because they simply don't spend the time that is needed. The result is knee-jerk or cookie-cutter diagnosis, in which habit replaces sound judgment based on careful examination. 7. Pediatricians are the most likely of all specialists to enhance their income by promoting and defending laws that force patients to use their services. It is pediatricians, not politicians, who are responsible for mandatory use of silver nitrate or antibiotic drops in a newborn's eyes, mandatory school physical examinations that provide opportunities for creative diagnosis of non-ailments, mandatory hospital births, and court-ordered use of controversial and unproven methods of treatment to which the parents object. Increasingly, one of the dangers inherent in taking your child to the doctor is the possibility that he may be taken from you and placed in state custody if you reject the treatment that his doctor demands. I have testified on behalf of the parents in many such legal actions in recent years. 8. Pediatricians are the principal foes of breastfeeding, despite incontrovertible evidence that it is one of the most effective ways to assure the future health of your child. Although the La Leche League is beginning to counter the influence that formula makers have long had on pediatricians, many doctors either fail to encourage or actively discourage breastfeeding. I won't go into all of the reasons for this, but it is worth noting that the growth of the pediatric specialty in the United States can be attributed in large measure to the financial support of the manufacturers of infant formula, who have long used pediatricians as unpaid salesmen. 9. Pediatricians give tacit support to the unconscionable obstetrical intervention that is damaging children, physically and intellectually. They cover up the obstetrician's role in producing much of the damage that they see. When a parent has a child with a birth defect and asks a pediatrician whether the obstetrician might be responsible, he will get the reply that is taught during pediatric residency. Don't look back, just look ahead. Dangerous obstetrical practices that produce retardation, learning disabilities, and physical abnormalities would disappear in a few years if pediatricians had the courage and compassion to place the blame on obstetricians, which is often where it belongs. Despite all this evidence of negative effects from pediatric care, the myth persists that American children enjoy better health care because of our abundance of pediatricians. That belief is wrong on two counts. First, infant mortality statistics reveal that American children are less healthy than those in many other developed nations that have fewer pediatricians. They're even less healthy than children in some of the underdeveloped countries.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.